8.
You're watching Clublife 98, the best of a rollicking year in dance music and clubbing. Coming up in the program, from the scruffy smiley face of 88 to the chic urban glamour of 98, we cast an eye over 10 years of club fashion. Warehouse began. We take Frankie Knuckles back to his Chicago roots. And the Prodigy kick back in our exclusive interview.
It's just a vibe which is in us, and it is like a drug, you know, you need that buzz, you know.
But first, in August, dance music magazine Mixmag ran a poll for readers to vote for the biggest and best of the year. Among the categories, DJ of the year, live act of the year, and club crowd of the year.
The poll really showed us how wide Mixmag readers' music taste is, but everything from, you know, banging house DJs to really underground experimental music. And it was really refreshing to see how much knowledge people had of the music.
Tonight, the results of the Mixmag Readers Poll are revealed exclusively here on Clublife 98. Who's setting the pace in Britain's dance music underground? There were some clear choices here. The Sub Club in Glasgow and the Bomb in Nottingham were just two of the contenders. But when the resident DJ says that it's like playing in the middle of a riot, and that DJ is Norman Cook, alias Fatboy Slim, it's got to be Brighton's Big Beat Boutique, the underground club of the year.
Norman and all the other DJs, Biffle General, Cutler Rock, etc., just playing records that they love. And it's always, you know, that's what it's about. Favourite records, people just enjoying themselves. Whether that's popular or not popular, we would still probably do it. Which is quite sad, because we could actually end up playing to nobody one day. I'm sure we will.
And it will be quite sad, won't it?
Yeah.
In the meantime, we're really chuffed because we're doing
well. Because there's loads of people here.
This is the famous queue.
Right over there, do you?
You don't mind waiting in the queue when you got the club right over there. John Carter's in the house.
And the Monkey Muffin.
That's right.
This is Fatboy Slim for the BBC. You're at the Big Beat Boutique. I'm one of the resident DJs, and apparently we are the underground club of the year.
Underground, overground, wombling free, that's where we are. Yeah. The policy is anything goes as long as the speaker blows. So it's obviously a policy which is pleasing the crowd.
The Big Beat Boutique Virgin. Such a good beat, it's brilliant. The people are nice, the bar staff, and it's really good atmosphere. It's friendly and everyone's like unity.
We could sit here and take all the credit, but to be honest, it's that lot there that made it more, because if they didn't go mad, then we'd have nothing. When you put a really good tune on, everyone used to just rattle the crowd control, and it's like the noise of it. It's like the biggest ovation you ever get. You put a good tune on, they'd all go do-do-do-do-do. And I've always said that playing here is like DJing in the middle of a riot.
Director, make sure that anything goes smooth and make sure DJs don't get too much trouble.
Yeah, it's my 19th birthday, so wicked. And the atmosphere here tonight is really, really good. It's a really big thing. It's really good. It's our era.
You can play all sorts of musical styles, which I think the DJs appreciate and the punters appreciate. No, I love it.
It's been time, especially like with the whole kind of big beat explosion, where we'll get bored one week and we'll just play a load of house records. Yeah, just to not do the done thing. And they always go with us and with it.
Yeah.
Whatever he's put in his box, I've got to follow there.
Yeah,
he's got to follow what
I've got. It's like a sparring thing. Whatever record he plays, it's like, I've got one like that, but it goes like this.
Thank you.
fashion. I've spent the last 10 years with fashion. Hanging it up, taking it down, giving a ticket, taking a ticket. I've seen all sorts of styles come and go. And you lot, you are fussy about what you wear. Sometimes even I lose track. So here, to guide you through the style maze, is DJ Paulette, who's taking a look at the eye catchers.
Like the music we dance to, what we wear when we're clubbing is always changing. At this Mixmag fashion shoot, they swept through the styles of the last decade. So, to make sense of it all, I talked to Wayne Hemingway of top label Red or Dead. So, just briefly, let's sum up the changes in club fashion over the last 10 years. Let's take 88 to 89, for instance.
Well, 88, you know, it was all about, it was quite an ethnic vibe going on, tie-dyeing. And those pretty awful, almost like South American kind of weaves that ended up being in sweatshirts and surf shops and things like that. Worn with a pair of often flared jeans and that long, long straight hair. And then in 89, the time that was a time where babies took over, this whole kind of thing about kids fashion. You had the kind of Junior Walton look of dungarees, you know, worn often with, to have one thing hanging off.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, half dressed. You know, half dressed. Just in from the field look.
Yeah, smiley t-shirts. And then all these baby accessories, you know, the things of the whistles and that, the fluorescent jewellery with the incandescent liquid in it. This is a short sleeve, but we did long sleeve t-shirts with a baby on the front. And then all down the sleeve, it had like babies all down. Yeah. And we were selling literally by the thousand. But the thing is, it was the acid house people wearing them, and it was the baby image, and you know, wearing them with the dummies because it was.
Yeah, sure.
And it was this really strange thing about, we just by chance, you know, we'd done Space, which was supposed to be about the future, and supposed to, it said, don't worry about the future, in safe hands, and it becomes this kind of acid house logo almost.
Yeah, absolutely.
And it was clubs that started called Space Baby. And it was all because of this baby image. Why did people become obsessed with babies? Why did they wear romper suits? Why did they wear dummies? Why did they suck? You know, it became fashionable to go to seaside towns and get those...
And buy the rock.
The rock and suck it. Now, I can't explain that. And it was, that, you know, that era was the time where nobody was interested in expensive design. Yeah. And it was just after Gaultier was kind of the clubber's god.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, you know, it's very easy to go down to a market and buy a pair of dyed dungarees and buy a smiley t-shirt from a place like Carnaby Street. So 1991 was, again, I think the biggest thing in fashion was a whistle, wasn't it? But it was like the baggy look, and then people started mixing it with tight sportswear. So you got, you know, you got your lads still wearing baggy clothes, but mixing it with either real Adidas and old school Adidas or kind of the faux Adidas. It was either two or three stripes.
Yes.
And all the high street was selling the two-striped look. And Adidas Adidas were going around probably like blue-ass flies thinking, what the hell's going on here? Everybody's copying us.
Then we do 1991, which was like hardcore, serious partygoers.
Yeah, these were the ravers we know and
love. They used to wear makeup and then it used to run down their face within about an hour of being in. But it never stopped them sort of like doing it to begin with.
Mm-hmm. The idea of Champion Sports, which is probably one of the naffest sports labels that's ever existed. And it's not even so naff that it's cool. You can understand if they pick up some really obscure old label like Buckter, which was like an old school label. But when they pick on something that's kind of associated with Jane Fonda or something like that,
you know.
From sort of 1991 days, there was a complete change as everyone started to dress up. The clubs started to have door policies. I think it was because raving had become so huge. Mm-hmm. There were this sort of slight elitist feel came about clubbing. Became more specialist, house clubs started, and so everyone started to have to dress up to get into the clubs.
Yeah, people started then, it was this new wave of London designers. There was John Richmond, there was Nick Coleman, there was Mitch Cocoshino. And it was all about, it was then about logos and a bit of a sharper way of dressing. I mean,
it was becoming okay to spend money on what you were wearing.
Yeah, but again, that became kind of mass market very quickly. The idea of wearing Destroy down it almost became like Boy London within a year, and it hit places like Mr. Byright very quickly and all those kind of stores.
Yeah.
There's never been a time where the label mattered. It was the person and how they put their outfit together that mattered, and all of a sudden it was about the logo.
Then for women, I think it also became a lot sexier. You could make an effort.
It became quite glam, and it was almost like you could almost see like bits of goth coming in there. There was a crucifix look and,
oh, yeah,
and the white faces, yeah, and things like that.
Yeah, but I mean, also pop stars had a lot to do with it. Say everything that Madonna was doing at the time.
Yeah.
So then we move on to 94, 95, and what were we seeing then?
Well, it started off like with Marabou and with a bit of like the Sign of the Times type look, and you know, quite kitsch and quite glam. And at first, you know, you look at it and think that, you know, that's getting a bit more clubby. That's how it should be. But because of the sheer mass people that were doing it, it became homogenised very quickly, and you end up with the kind of pre-Spice Girls look of crop tops, pierced midriffs, mini skirts, yeah, and high platform
tiger
boots.
Tiger print, leopard, you know, print for like girls and for boys.
Well, 96, 97, two things kind of came together. There was no such thing as anymore as the indie kid and the yeah, club kid. And like, whereas in the past, a clubber would never have wanted to look like somebody who was in an indie band. Somebody like Jarvis Cocker would never have appealed to a club kid.
Yeah, this is what we're seeing.
You know, it was all right to look like an indie geek. It was all right to wear an anorak. You couldn't really tell what kind of music that person was into, other than that they were quite cool.
Yeah.
And it's something, you know, this, it kind of appealed to me a lot more than this last few years, and it's been going the way that I would think it should go. It's not trashy. You could seek out individual things. You could wear a second-hand granddad top with a 70s printed American NAF golfing shirt, yeah, or something, and put a pair of geek glasses on, and that was fine.
Yeah.
Even, you could even have a bad haircut.
Well, bad
cool
haircuts are us, yeah, these days, yeah, aren't they? So what about 1998 and then on into the millennium? What are we going to see? What are the predictions?
Well, my prediction is that it's all about individuals now, and it's all about dipping into, you know, the leaders are going to dip into a bit of designer wear, a bit of secondhand, a bit of stuff that they've had lying around for a bit, you know, mixing cool shapes and layering with a bit of irony here and there, and just pushing on mm-hmm, and not... certainly wanting, when something becomes mass market, not sticking with it like happened in the late 80s and early 90s, but moving on quickly and reinventing
it
and change, mm, and wanting to move forward. I mean, we're entering into a new millennium, and you know, the last thing you want to do is stand still.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, thank you.
Cheers.
There was some tough competition in the live act category from Underworld, Represent, Massive Attack and the Chemical Brothers. But Mixmag readers voted overwhelmingly for the one dance act who've taken the live experience further than anyone else. They played in Moscow, Beirut and Brazil, won more awards and sold more records than any act in dance music history. It could only be the Prodigy.
Shut up, Hunter! Come on! Only! Only! Who wants it? Brixton! It's the Prodigy!
When Jilted Generation came out, the whole of the dance scene just went like that and split up into so many different categories. You know, I mean, you basically had lots of more bands trying to experiment with more sort of more rockier sounds. The Chemical Brothers came out and then this sort of big beat thing emerged. Do you know what I mean? A lot of the hardcore tunes we were listening to back in sort of 91 is the same stuff, do you know what I mean? To be honest, with a new label on it. But just because the hardcore scene wasn't seen to be cool, you know, they have to put a new label on it and try and say, yeah, well, this is the new thing, you know, this is cool now.
Oh, I see ya!
But when people tried to label us a techno act in 91, you know, we weren't techno, do you know what I mean? It's like, I was into techno, Derek May and kind of a lot of stuff that was coming out of Germany and stuff like that, and that wasn't what we were doing, but it was an easy label to have put on us, you know? But we didn't want that, you know? We were like, no, this is, we're just a hard dance act.
You get to a certain level of people respecting you, and then people want to tear you down, do you know? But, you know, yeah, as long as you keep it real to yourself, then it will always be real, do you know? And stick to what you believe, do you know? As soon as you start going off at a tangent, then, yeah, people have got a right to diss you and say, you're doing this, you're doing that, do you know what I mean? But we keep it raw.
I mean, when we first started, it was all paranoid, walking around thinking, oh shit, yeah, we've got to be like really careful, we stay underground, you know, and all that shit. But it's all bollocks, really, because at the end of the day, there's nothing wrong with coming out and saying, yeah, here we are, we're large, do you know what I mean? Mm. As long as the music's good, still. Mm. As long as the music stays on one level and we all always know where we're going with that. You know, it's all down to the music, you know, and if the music's crap and it starts going off into another pop land, then that's where we come unstuck, you know?
People don't understand. They think that we go out on stage and it's all theatrical, you know. It's not theatrics, do you know what I mean? It's not something where we just go out and think, oh yeah, we're gonna do this, we're gonna do that. It's all vibes which we feel inside, do you know what I mean? It's just the way we express ourselves. And so it's not an act, you know, it's not a show. It's just vibes. It's just energy, the way we express ourselves to music.
You don't look in the mirror and start sort of pulling faces and thinking, yeah, that's going to work great on stage, because it just doesn't. You feel like a cock. But when you're out there, you're like, and we have it loud on stage, and it is in your face, and the music itself is in your face, and the energy that we get off of each other is in your face, and the people are in your face, and then, you know, and then it builds into something, and
it's just a vibe which is in us, and it is like a drug, you know. You need that buzz, you know. In the dance scene, we was just limiting ourselves and just listening to dance music and nothing else, you know. And we realised that, we got to a stage and realised that there's more music out there, more ideas to take upon and take on board, and just new inspirations and put that into the show. Like, you know, me and Keith, we get buzz like 2-3 years ago, it was Rhythm of Life, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And then
even though we had the newer tracks in there, that still was like the springboard to sort of bring the energy up.
Because it was quite confrontational.
Confrontational
between me and Keith.
Smack the bitch up goes down really well.
Oh, God! Can I hear Brixton tonight? Are you ready? Brazil was quite good.
Yeah, Brazil
was good.
Because
it was unexpected, really, you know? And the crowd were quite mad. It just went down so well. You know, it's a good buzz when you don't expect something to be, you know, as so-called your home territory, because, you know, you always class England as being, like, the pinnacle, you know, so to speak, do you mean? You know, this is where it goes off, you know, because people understand it more here. You know, and when you go to other countries and they go off in the same way, you just give them respect.
Beirut was good though, wasn't it? Because all through the day when we were sort of setting up, it was on and off, and like it was in like a car park in the middle of sort of the city, and you can imagine the sort of backdrop, loads of bombed out buildings and stuff. And then it started to rain, the stage blew down, and we actually ended up going down in the rain, going on in the rain. And to the left was like a big sort of bypass, and there was about 3,000 people standing on the bypass looking over the stage. So it was pretty much chaos in the whole city, do you know what I mean? That was really good.
We was like the first band to be there for, who was the last person?
10 there? Years or so.
Shirley Bassey or something. What the hell's that? What the hell's that? What the hell's
that? I hate Russia. I mean, Russia's the most depressing place I've ever been to. It's like, the sky is actually like 100 metres from the ground, and then that's it, just grey. And I've never been so depressed in my whole life, but the show was incredible, you know. And I couldn't wait to get out of there. I would have sold my gran to get through customs quicker. What the hell's that? What the hell's that?
Press sort of makes people appear to be sometimes bigger than they are. You know, like in America, we're not big. Do you know what I mean? But the press of saying, yeah, Prodigy have broken America. You know, we're not big in America. Do you know what I mean? Oasis aren't big in America.
We're not even small in America.
Do you know what I mean? And you read the press and Prodigy have broke America. They're huge. You know, and we're just not. Do you know what I mean? You know, it's like a. It's not about that. All I know is when I go there and we play on stage, we have a good time. I mean,
you could talk about America for hours and sort of pick it to bits, but you, from my point of view, however shit everything else is, when you go on stage, yeah. That is usually when it's all over and done with, and it ain't in America. You know, in America, you have to think about whatever you do. Yeah.
Lawsuits and shit like
lawsuits.
That.
Lawsuits. I mean, I had people, you know, jumping up and down after the shows, shouting at the manager saying that they were going to sue me and all that for spitting at them. You know, you go out into the crowd and stuff, and I really enjoy that. But they hold everyone back, yeah. And, you know, if anyone makes a break for it and trips over, you sue. You know, they really sue at the drop of a hat, and it's almost as if they don't realise that they're putting a cap on all their entertainment because, you know, shows aren't just shows. We turn up and you see all these seats in front of you. You know, we just can't do this. We can't have all these people, you know, sat in front of us. We're not used to that. And, you know, it's just frustrating. The whole place winds you up.
Say the hip-hop business over there. Business, yeah, it is a business. But, like, you know, loads of bands sell out over there, don't they? They kind of use stupid samples and real commercial shit and earn loads of money. But no one ever says, hang on a minute, LL Cool J, you really sold out there. You know, you used to be like really sort of cool in the hip hop scene. You've really sold out. Do you know what I mean? And then just because he's got money, he gets respect. Do you know what I mean? He's got his own sitcom now. You know, what's that? Do you know what I mean? I used to respect that. I'm gonna get shot now. That's your fucking luck.
You're watching Clublife 98. still to come. The coolest band in the world? Massive Attack speak out.
But there's always tension in music, you know, and sometimes it's a good thing, sometimes it's a bad thing. But when it is a strong creative process and we all feel strongly about what we're doing, we're going to come up against each other, you know, quite heavily sometimes, you know, and there's going to be a lot of aggravation, but that's just the way we've always been. I think we've always been quite aggravational, you know.
It's just all here, all the people are here from years gone by, like top DJs, etc. So, yeah, it's quite spiritual as well.
For me, all my dreams have come true here.
Everyone looks after one another. Scratch my back, I'll scratch yours, sort of thing.
Met loads of people from across the world.
Get up, you're forming to it. It's easy. It's hard. Just gotta have it in you. Just gotta get up and go.
Track of the summer. I could say Stardust, but I'm not going to.
You've got a certain kind of people, you know, have the same way of partying and like the same things as you do, and they all get together here. We all come, you know, it's like the particular thing about Ibiza is that everybody comes here and you actually end up liking the same things, liking the same music, you know. It's the same taste, I think, the same way of, you know, enjoying yourself.
Is like where I learned, you get what I'm saying, and understood a bit more what was actually going on back in the day. So like, I come here every day to try and come back every year for the energy of it.
It's all very easy to say, why do people come to Manumission? I mean, the reason we made it out here in the first place was what we do is very akin to what the island's about. We're atmosphere based, it's about party, it's about entertainment.
And then for us, when we first came to Ibiza, I think the Pasha was probably the club that influenced us more than any other club on the island. It seems that you're with a set of like-minded people. People come to this island, they've been influenced by the island. And it just, that's what creates this unique atmosphere and it makes it such a unique place. It's kind of like-minded people all coming to the same place for the same reason year after year. Love might bring us back together. I feel so
good. That's what Ibiza is about. You know, you go out there and you share and you're together because we're, you know, every kind of people gets together. Love might bring us back together. And suddenly they go into another direction and it has to become all very VIP and snobby and celebrity and stick together between us. And if you start doing that in Ibiza, things go wrong. You know, you can't do that. Stop that. It's not nice.
Junior Sanchez, and his shoes.
This is what Creamfields is about, right there.
We've had intentions, I suppose, or let's just say, ideas on how festivals should be run for the last few years, you know? They're kind of, the rock-orientated festivals, in a way to us, hijacking the dance world by giving them a little tent on the side of side of a field is not the way to do it, you know. So when Meanfielder approached us in beginning of December, you know, it took us about 5 seconds to say, yeah, that's a good idea, really.
America's not that open-minded to do it. They have raves, but not of this caliber. It's just, this is like out, you got drum and bass, you got all these house DJs. It's just, it's definitely, it's more intricate than America. It's just, they don't got the head for it.
The people that we've invited here, that like Full Cycle, Trade, Bugged Out, are the people that we feel are the best at, you know, in their field, really. You know, they're the cream of what they do. We don't do their thing, but if we did, we'd like to do it like them, you know what I'm saying?
All it is about enjoying yourself and playing records to people and making them dance. Some DJs nowadays just like think that they are doing something that is like so important. It's important to a point, but it's not that important.
People ask DJs when they started DJing, as it's one of those perennial journalist questions, right? And if you get a bit old and a bit over the hill, it's a bit like asking a woman their age. You simply don't do it. So I'm not telling you when I started DJing. It was sometime around 1995.
It's mad, you don't get anything like this at home. You know, just people and the music just pumps over here. Some really good DJs.
It's piping!
There's 30,000 people out there in the middle of the night. You know, and the music, 90% of this music is not played daytime on Radio 1. So that's underground.
Really superb.
Yeah.
It's a blast!
Reaching out to one and all in one. It's all about the carnival special. Everyone who possesses a horn, a whistle, and lift the right hand. This one will burn a hole in the side of the moon.
The purpose is, as you can see behind, to put a melting pot of people together to create what is quite clearly the biggest jungle night of the year.
Well, you know, drum and bass has been around for like 10 years now, do you know what I mean? In the last 5 years, it's cultivated itself and moved on. And with the likes of Ronnie Size, Goldie, you know, Voltec, loads of other artists signing up and going forward, it's just opened the doors to the majors, do you know what I mean? So more people are taking notice, more people are getting involved. And for the first time, England has had its own music, do you know what I mean?
Festival out there, it's just like what London's needed. Like,
it's been a good night.
Yeah, it's been no good parties in London for ages.
It was a good night, man.
Yeah. Rocking. It's just enjoyment, you get what I'm saying? It's like too much people specifying where you're going, what's happening. We're just enjoying it. And I think that's been the success of V, you get what I'm saying? Not trying to look too far into the future, just taking things as they come and just enjoying it. Sounding bad, sounding fine. When the lights are down by the beeline, it's another fight up in line by line. Why should the beat receive it this time? Sounds of the sounds, the sounds, sounds are fine. Drunk with the rhythm, I check the baseline. Check for the mix, we keep it inside. Select the treble, select the baseline. Sounds of the sounds, the sounds, the sounds fine. Like we've done a lot of travelling, right? We've been to a lot of places, and I think that's what makes London, especially one of the most unique places in the world for clubs. Do you know what I mean? That fact that you can come over it and it's such a melting pot of styles and music that people come from abroad and they appreciate it, because you can be stuck in like a club in Italy or anywhere in Europe and just be hearing like techno or be hearing like one particular thing. But you come here, you look in Time Out magazine or you look somewhere like that, right?
And you're going to see like a whole lot of things. And that's the unique thing about London, you know what I mean?
Where's the dust of it gone?
Such reality as something.
Album of the Year was the category that really showed how broad dance music has become, with Madonna, the Beastie Boys, Deep Dish and Air all scoring votes from Mixed Mag readers. But it seems fitting that perhaps the most influential British dance act of all should end up winning. Their third album, released this year, is dark, intense and heavily influenced by their stunning live shows. It was a clear winner. They are Massive Attack, and the album is Mezzanine.
Well, yeah, our records have got some glimmer of hope in them. You know, I wouldn't say it was all dowdy and dark. You know what I mean? Quite positive, and I think they're quite real.
We didn't sort of think about anything like to make a dark album. I think it was just, like I said, more reflective of like, maybe some of the moods that were going around. And some of the, maybe some of the sonics and some of the contrast between the different instruments made it feel that way. It was quite a difficult record to make in places. I think we knew that it wasn't going to be as accessible maybe as the previous album.
Reckon, let me, darling, raise me to your lips. Two undernourished egos, four retaining hips. Hold on to me, darling, I'm a sliding scale.
And even is, as people have sort of pointed out, a dark record, people must obviously find something in it that they it appeals to them and doesn't make them feel depressed.
You know, it's not as though we all sort of saw eye to eye on this one. You know, sometimes we're kind of used to working in a certain way and, you know, having to sort of expand on what we did is we had to sort of pull ourselves out of the shell, really, you know what I mean? And that kind of made it hard.
Tension in music, you know, and sometimes it's a good thing, sometimes it's a bad thing, but when it is a strong creative process and we all feel strongly about what we're doing, we're going to come up against each other, you know, quite heavily sometimes, you know, and there's going to be a lot of aggravation, but that's just the way we've always been. I think we've always been quite aggravational, you know, and very stubborn as well, so it's part of it, really, part of the process. We were working with a lot of new digital setup and recording a lot of stuff to hard disk on Pro Tools, a new computer system for us really on this album. That it was a good way for us using a lot of live instrumentation, doing a lot of jams, and then digitally converting them and trying to make a good sort of balance between digital and real instruments, which I think was important to get that kind of real organic feel to something which is quite digital in places, you know. Bristol's always had quite a strong musical community, and we've obviously met a lot of people, collaborated with a few people, and it felt natural for us to want to sort of have an outlet to put some of that stuff out.
Traveling the world for the last, you know, year now on tour, and you know the world's that small, and really we don't see any need to move to London. You know, we've always been able to do our own thing, and you know we've always been quite individual down here, so there's no need for us, you know, to move to London at all.
We've got a couple of new bands we've signed to Melancholic in the last sort of 6 months, Bristol based as well, and you know it's going to be a pretty good year next year for Melancholic because we've got a lot of stuff coming out, and Bristol is, you know, has got a very kind of quite deep musical thing going on. And it's not just what you see on the outside us or Portishead or Ronnie Size and Represent. There's a lot of other things going on as well, which hopefully we can highlight, you know, over the next couple of years. What's your next? write, we will all sample, we will all sort of like put lyrical ideas down. We all have the capability to mix and arrange tracks the way we feel is right. And that's probably why we argue so much, because, you know, if we all had set roles, set instruments, then we'd all rely on each other to make the whole thing complete. But I think, to a certain extent, we all have the knowledge and have all slightly outgrown each other in our knowledge, you know, so that's because we all have quite strong visions. It makes it quite difficult sometimes to come together, you see.
Now this is where I feel happiest. Playing the records that send a shiver down your spine, put a smile on your face, and make you rush the dance floor. It's been an exciting decade for DJs, and we've all developed styles of our own. But the art of the DJ might have evolved very differently if it wasn't for one man, Frankie Knuckles. So let's join Mix Mag's Don Phillips as he sets out with the legendary godfather of house.
I used to always think that what I did was create kind of a poor man's paradise on a dance floor. It gives them an opportunity to completely escape the rigors of reality and just be one with themselves and hundreds of other people at the same time that could be told strangers.
Frankie Knuckles' story is the story of house music itself. Born in the underground gay clubs of New York and Chicago, house is now an international sound, and Frankie DJs all over the world. So I asked John Brown, Frankie's tour manager, how it all began.
Do I recall when I met Frankie Knuckles? It was about 23 or 24 years ago, and I was working for Kool & the Gang. He was a disc jockey in New York City, and he was coming to pick up records. And we just hit it off, right? We had a similar sensibility about music and a similar sensibility about human beings. We both enjoyed really deep soul music. We both really had a taste for it, you know, and it was great. It was a great time. It was the early 70s, and we really, all kinds of music was being played.
To really make the whole room just move in one complete rhythm and all those people come together and just be one big force of energy, you have to be a part of that. You have to put yourself in the middle of that. And a lot of times I used to think it would be great if the DJ booth was like right in the center of the dance floor and then everybody was around you, but the booth would take up too much room in the center of the dance floor and therefore you wouldn't have a heart. I mean, the heart of the party is right in the center of the dance floor.
A hot dance floor in Ibiza and the crowd locks into Frankie's sound. He developed this distinctive style at the end of the 70s at a Chicago club which has since passed into legend. The Warehouse.
I'd already been playing in New York for 5 years, and when the club closed, it was kind of depressing to me because it was one place I had, it's the only place I had ever really played, and I had only really known. And so when I got the Warehouse, it was an opportunity for me to build something from the ground up on my own. And more than anything, I wanted to make it a world inside of itself, and I wanted to make it the kind of place where people would come there and really rejoice and be happy about who they are.
We took Frankie back of house music. A trip like this would be incomplete without a visit to the original site of the Warehouse. No longer a heaving club, it's now the office of a firm of lawyers.
So Frankie, 206 South Jefferson, site of the original Warehouse. It's been a while, eh?
It's been quite some time, actually.
Bet you never thought you'd be coming back in this building.
I've passed it many times, and you know, Frederick and I will drive past here when I'm usually visiting. We'll stop and blow kisses to it, you know, say prayers, you know, it's like Mecca. But no, I never dreamed that I would actually be walking back up in this building again.
So how long has it been? How long has it been?
15, maybe 16 years. We closed the Warehouse in 83.
1983?
1983.
Okay, let's go in.
Okay.
A little bit different. Are you kidding? I'm gagging. I'm not prepared. Look at this place. Because right here was my record closet.
What, this?
It was bigger than this, actually. I mean, they've walled it in somewhat, but this is where I used to keep all my records at, underneath the stairs here. They've completely replaced these windows, because what we had up here were glass block windows. Uh-huh. And at the top, we had vents up there. And we can control the vents back on the loading dock. And so in the wintertime, when Chicago's known for its winters, where it can get really cold, as opposed to having fog machines in, I'd hit the switch in the back, and the vents would open up, and we'd have instant natural fog. Rise fog, and it was perfect.
So you guys have heard of house music, right?
Of course.
Sure. But you didn't know, but it started right here in your offices.
No, I didn't.
No? Yeah. It didn't start right in this office, did it?
In this building.
Well, underneath. Yeah. Well, they've got a meeting room downstairs. That was the dance floor.
And did they have a liquor license or no?
No, juice bar.
It was a juice bar.
What time would it open up?
At midnight.
Yeah.
So right. Noon the next day. Sometimes midnight the next night, depending on how well I felt. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Were you the DJ or did you own it? Or?
I was the DJ.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm.
He lived here for a bit.
I lived here for a while. I lived up in this office for like about 6 months.
Who did you rent the building from?
The Foster Company.
Oh, really? Water Saver?
Water Saver. It was their building.
Did the police ever give you any trouble?
No, actually, we never had a problem with the police. We had a problem with the church once around the corner. It was one Easter Sunday.
Sunday morning.
One Easter Sunday. Okay. You know, I mean, we had like a bazillion people up in here, you know, and they were screaming having church up in here, and they were trying to have church around the corner, and the religions were clashing. So let's put it like that. So it didn't quite work.
Pretty amazing.
You want to see some pictures?
Sure.
This will freak you out.
I don't know if I have any pictures, shots of up here. But downstairs, this is the front of the building. Those are the two gentlemen that I did that I was doing the warehouse with. And that's in the front of the building.
Mad Styles there.
And that was like 19...
Yeah, you can really see like the outfit.
That's probably like 1979, 1980.
Oh, yeah.
Here's a shot from outside, looking towards Presidential Towers. You notice they're gone. That's the building right there. That's a shot of the dance floor with people on it. But this is one from the loading dock area where I had to DJ booth that. But here's a great shot. That's what the room looked like downstairs.
You guys pack like that every night?
Every Saturday.
Every Saturday, you mean?
We do anywhere between 800 and 1,400 people.
So house music started here?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Really?
It was named after the warehouse.
Yeah.
Okay.
They got its name from the warehouse, which was this building.
Now, which door are they walking in here?
This one here.
This one, okay.
The bottom one.
At the bottom of the stairs.
They told us it's a plumbing company.
Yeah, they didn't mention you on the sales brochure.
While the warehouse partied like there was no tomorrow, Frankie developed a new DJing technique. It was more than just playing records. Using an old-fashioned reel-to-reel tape recorder and a turntable, he'd transfer his tunes onto tape, cut them up, turn them around, and rearrange them. A new form of music had arrived.
The industry wasn't really putting out any music with real energy to it. Everything was either... It was either very deep and very soulful and slow, or it was country western. Mm-hmm. Those are your two choices. And so they weren't really putting out anything that had any real energy to it. So most of the records that were coming out that had any energy was coming from either out of Canada or coming from Europe. And what happened was I figured the only way I can keep my dance floor interested is that I had to redo, I had to take some of the older songs and try and like re-edit them or remix them is what I thought I was doing with them.
Right.
To keep their interest, because I figured there wasn't that much new music coming out.
So show me what you do.
Okay.
With this, because this is one of the tracks you used to use, right?
Yeah, this was a real big classic at the warehouse. Every good DJ scratches a record every now and then. Take this section a couple times and extend it, and then just let it end the way it naturally does. So really the only thing I did was I changed the intro and I changed the middle.
Right.
And I mean, if you were listening very closely, you know, sometimes what they were singing didn't really make sense. But it would play tricks on people's, you know, hearing when they're on the dance floor, because right, they think right. They know that they know the song, and it'll start singing one particular way, and all of a sudden it would go in another direction. Still the same song, but lyrically it would go in another direction, and people would be on the dance floor. I don't remember that.
The night before going on a tour of Japan, Frankie got together with some of his friends from the warehouse days. The DJ and his original dance floor had been reunited. It was time to reminisce.
The only clubs that actually had DJs in them were the white clubs on the north side. And the only clubs outside of that that had a DJ in it was the warehouse. And there were no black DJs playing in any of the clubs on the north side, you know. And remember how all those clubs, like Alfie's and Blink, they all had quotas for how many blacks they were letting in?
Absolutely.
And stuff like that, all that kind of stuff?
Broadway and Melody.
Uh-huh, all of them.
Required me to join with Michael when I came to Chicago myself, because, you know, they antagonized us at the door. So, you know, I wasn't accustomed being out of New York. Right.
Yeah.
They asked me for so many IDs. I couldn't believe it. I said, well, do you want me to bring my mother and the doctor?
As the city was taking hold of this here particular new effect of style, lifestyle, living. I mean, we're talking about in a period when America was going through a sexual revolution. It was fun to be this. You had to have a gay friend. You had to have this, that, and the other.
Remember all these straight kids that were running around pretending to be gay?
Just
so they could be a part of
the sheer essence of it created a style for people to say that, you know, wow. The word out on the street was, have you heard about this hit club right here called The Warehouse? It's
definitely the college kids, it is something else
down in there. You won't believe it.
But wait, could you remember when you could go to another party and if you saw a person dance a certain way, you knew they went
you
to the warehouse?
You said, that's the house kids right there. They go to the warehouse.
Now, this is interesting. The first time I actually heard the word house, first time I heard them call the house, we were out on the south side, and we were driving past this bar, and there was a sign in the window. It was like a little tavern, you know, an Amen Corner or something like that. Okay, and there was a sign in the window that said, we play house music.
Oh.
I said, well, what is that?
They played at home.
No, that music that you play down at the warehouse.
Okay.
Was what the, you know, I was like, really?
Also, what made it unique, I think, was that when you could get up at 4 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah.
Thank you.
5 o'clock in the morning.
That's
make
hard.
Your way down there. A lot of people didn't have cars.
Right.
You get on a bus, you get on a train.
You
get there at 6 o'clock, and you can stay there to 12, sometimes almost 1 o'clock.
You have as much time as you need to jack as hard as you jack.
You go in and you say, my God, it's a world in and of itself. And look at that, and look at that, and look at what they're doing, and listen to that music, and look at what the music is doing to him, and look at what she's got on, and oh my God, you know. And then my mother, I got a mother coming to the club story. My mother came to the club one night with my best friend's mother. My mother had a 45 in her jeans, and she met Robert at the door. And Robert said, hello, how can I help you? And she said, I'm here to retrieve my daughter, Elisa, and it was about 2 a.m., I guess. I wasn't even at the party yet. So Robert invited her in, you know, didn't charge her admission or anything, said, you are welcome to go and get your child. And she went in, and I think Jeffrey took her throughout the club, all three levels. And they came out empty-handed, and she said, this is where she spends her Saturday nights. I can't believe it.
Chicago's everything. It's influenced me in every kind of way. I like to think that I was born and raised in New York, but I grew up in Chicago. I did most of my education in New York, but I got my education in life and learned how to be the person I am here in Chicago. Chicago awarded me that. It's made it possible for me to be exactly who I am. I don't think if I had stayed in New York, I would be doing the same thing now.
Who are these people, and why have they been voted Club Crowd of the Year? Stay with Club Life 98 and find out. Every great record needs a great remix, and there's been plenty of choice for DJs this year. There were votes for Sasha and his remix of Madonna's Ray of Light, and for Norman Cook, yes, him again, with his remix of Corner Shop's Brimful of Asher. But it's Germany's Gnarlin and Kane who've come up trumps with their 98 remix of Energy 52's Ibiza classic, Café Del Mar.
Total angel, and we play lots of music here at home, so he likes to dance a bit like his nanny. Doing you dancing, that's right. the only person social is with during the day is Aaron, which is why I think that I probably enjoy going out every weekend and socialising. I never used to like hard house at all, but the atmosphere in there is electric. There's nothing like Trade's dance floor. It is absolutely amazing. I go there with a lot of my gay friends, and for me personally, I prefer to go to gay clubs. Oh, and I mean, I've got a lot of straight friends that go there, don't get me wrong, there's a lot of straight friends, and they feel the same. I think, you know, they can be completely silly without anybody really judging what you're up to. I mean, it's full of all different sorts. You've got like huge, big, muscly guys who are half naked in their jeans, flexing the muscles. And then you've got like really skinny guys. They've also got no tops on, but you know, it's just like anything goes. I can see the swings. And we're gonna go on them. Lately, nannies have had a lot of bad press. And I think they think, oh, nanny's a party girl, she's no good. I think I'm quite good at my job. And what I do for weekends is my business. If I had a baby and I was to hire a nanny, I wouldn't hire one who didn't socialise over weekends, because how's your baby going to learn any social skills? We were there the other week till 1 in the afternoon, so we said, oh, should we go in the hard house room for the last 20 minutes? And it's like everyone's dancing really, really loads to get like the wear out of the last 20 minutes of praise. You catch someone's eye and they're like smiling, yeah, you know, it's really, really good. And then you come out of there, and if you've forgotten your shades, it's definitely a crime, because you have to have your shades when you come out of trade. If I wasn't a clubber in London and I was just a nanny and I didn't really go out every weekend, I'd have no mates at all, because I really don't get on with that many nannies to socialise with.
On the 2nd of July this year, Clubland was stunned by the tragic news that Tony DeVee, one of Britain's best-loved DJs, had died. After 20 years as a struggling DJ, Tony was finally getting the recognition he deserved for a sound that was fiercer, yet funkier, than anything else around. He'd played every major club in Britain, and most of the minor ones too, and throughout it all, he never stopped smiling.
I think one of Tony's most memorable sets was one quite a few years ago now. I didn't know him then, but he used to speak about the first Chuff Chuff he ever did. And it was him and his best friend were up on the stage, and his best friend had managed to talk the promoters from Moneypenny's into putting Tony on after Sasha. And Tony went on and Sasha was playing his set. And as Tony went on, the place erupted and went mad, because like the energy and the music. And I think that was like the time when he thought, you know, I'm making it now. There's a small town called Stamford. We used to play a nightclub called Central there. And two Asian lads came in and said, oh yeah, Tony, you've got to see our menu, you've got to see our menu. And Tony was like, okay, show me. And they showed him the menu, and on the bottom of the menu it said the Tony DeVee curry, the hottest curry in the house, which was quite nice. He always said most famous people, you get roses named after them, but you got a curry instead.
I think it's really sad that he was taken away from us just when he was given the opportunity to really, really speak. You know, just when everyone would have been really ready to hear his music and to hear his records, you know, it all had to stop. I think that's really, really rotten.
Clubs like Trade is so well known around the straight scene now, which that you just wouldn't have happened without Tony. there's no way it would have crossed over onto the... I mean, it may have done eventually, but nowhere near as soon without the Tony connection there.
Tony's strengths as a DJ was the fact that he worked so hard. That was his strength, but also it was his weakness, because I just think he worked far too hard.
As soon as he got up, he'd be running about all over the place, doing this, doing that. Then he'd go out to do probably 3 gigs and come home and then get up again after 3 hours sleep. It's that's exactly how his music was. It just didn't ever stop. It was just constant.
Even when he was doing remixing and when he was still DJing maybe 4 or 5 gigs a week around the country, he'd still kept down a full-time job. And when he gave up that full-time job, that man was out there. He was working it all the time. He would always make sure that the people were having a good time. If they weren't dancing to the music, he'd put on something that would make them dance. He's very unique.
He just had a lot of time for everyone, whether it was some sweating clubber to, his family, his friends. He was always there. He'd go around to his mum's once a week, twice a week. He'd, be out with his best friend, Alex, one or two times a week. He'd always be with the people who really mattered rather than the people who were in, if you know what I mean.
I literally had been in the office, it was about 15 minutes, and someone said, it was actually Simon Sadler from Kiss phoned up, and the lawyer that works for us one day a week said, there's someone on the phone. I said, well, what's it about? Because I was having meetings at the time. He said, well, it's about Tony. And I said, well, can you turn my phone in back? He said, no, he said, he's dead. So it was 15 minutes, so it was it really threw me, because it had been such a shit summer. And then to come back to find out that, your friend of 7.5 years and the person that, helped to build your name and club has also died is a bit of a shock.
One of Tony's friends said, after he died, he said the reason why it had happened was obviously God needed a DJ and he'd pick the best one.
Two clubs, one crowd, one DJ. These are the votes that really count. DJ of the year was closely fought. Sasha, Norman Cook and Paul Oakenfold all got honourable mentions. But the winner by a whisker was Judge Jules. Let's follow him as he journeys in one packed night from the mega club of the year, Cream in Liverpool, over to Sheffield and Gatecrasher to play to a bunch of loonies who could only be the Clublife 98 crowd of the year.
Very pleased and proud that Cream has won Mega Club of the Year in these awards. It's an award that means something because it's voted for by the general public. The crowd at Cream is second to none. I've only been here 2 months and I've been blown away at how friendly and up for it they are. Coming into Cream as an outsider, I think this crowd has really helped us maintain our position.
Nice door staff.
Actually, have a conversation with you rather than just tell you where to go.
Pasties, I can't big myself up. Pasties.
We come to Cream because my auntie knows the manager and they're very nice. So we come down because the music's great and so is the atmosphere.
And you've got all the different
and
rooms.
People are very friendly. This is my mum and she brought me here for the first time because this is my first time. And it's my auntie's 30th party, so that's why we came.
We've all had a brilliant night, right? She got us drunk before we got here, so we haven't had a problem.
Cheers.
thank you so much for voting me DJ of the Year. It's a bit of a shock, to put it mildly. A law student studying law at probably one of Britain's best universities, watching all these people go off to be barristers and solicitors, and I almost had to mumble under my breath when I graduated, I want to be a DJ. Looking back on it, probably I'm the happiest person of that whole, of the class of whenever it was that I studied. Reason behind my soundtrack is finding those records that will go on to be big. It would be very boring and very predictable to be playing those at the same time as all other DJs were doing it, but I have no shame about the fact that I do play records that will go on to be hits.
Guaranteed night, you know.
You know it's gonna be good. I go out to clubs and I try to be like a clubber. I think there's an awful lot of DJs who are quite, maybe a bit anal, maybe a bit anoraky, for whom DJing is a release of a kind of shy side of their persona. Whereas for me, I'm not a particularly shy person. I really enjoy going to clubs, like dancing, like. If I could literally jump into the crowd and do it, then I probably would. There's an immediacy of feedback that you get in a club situation that you simply wouldn't get in a rock concert environment.
Okay then, at this point we are faced with a stark choice. Do we all go home or do we make rather a lot of din and get perhaps one, if we're very lucky, two more shoes? You let me win.
The success of clubs is the fact that our generation has been increasingly frightened to know their neighbours. And I think clubs are the last bastion of an opportunity for people to go out on equal terms and meet people they've never met before without any degree of fear. And that creates the warm environment of the dance culture. My lifetime ambition, the moment I started on pirate radio and then went on to local radio, I always wanted to get on Radio 1. It's nice to be able to kind of expose other people to a music taste and not be able to hear them saying this is rubbish in return. These things are going to go on for a long time. I count myself very lucky to have been in the right place at the right time, but I'm doing what I love. I'm playing at clubs that are absolutely fantastic. Let's enjoy this for as long as is possible. We're on our way to Gatecrasher's fourth birthday. It's 4:10 in the morning. We've got about 52 minutes to get there, and we've probably got about an hour's worth of journey, so here's hoping we'll get there in time.
What do you expect from Gatecrashers, the sexiest people in England in here?
John's like the Gatecrashers mascot, always.
Oh, no, really? No. I've been going to Gatecrashers for a long time. It's the most dressed up crowds, isn't it, Steph?
Yeah, I mean, we like to dress up. Everybody likes to dress up.
If everybody else gets dressed up as well, it just makes it really exciting. You just like go, yeah, come on, everyone. It's just a hook.
I know, I've got hooked onto
the chainmail. You attached my chainmail. Oh, yeah, my God. I love the chainmail, but I'm not sure about the chainmail.
Well, let's have a look at it.
You're still hooked. You're hooked. You're hooked
popped on my nipple.
There's nothing better than like coming here after you've had a hard week and just letting your hair down. Just the best
and
way.
And going wild.
It's gonna have to
Thank
be my
yeah.
spaceman outfit.
Bye. Let's get. Bye. People are placing me up in this corset and it's volunteers.
Oh, hang on.
It's getting boobs pulled off.
For me, it's just about pure enjoyment and dancing and just having a good time and meeting people like Kelly. Met her in Ibiza.
This is my spaceman outfit, complete with the flashing, vibrating gun.
One time when a soaring tune came on, he's like, that's like that.
Because they were hard tunes.
And also, this, we hammer it all, don't we?
And you've got hammering tunes like that for really hard tunes. And then gay crush people are so mad we've got still dancing where we just lay on the floor, dance for a bit with arms in the air and just sit still, lay still for about half a minute at least and just be mad. We are the maddest bunch of nutters in the whole of Britain.
Women dress very sexily here, yeah, and just, but it's done tastefully. The blokes here respect that. They don't lech the women here. They enjoy having women show themselves off in a sexual way, and it adds to the atmosphere. It kind of really makes everybody buzz up a bit more.
Homemade.
We made them.
Yeah.
Absolutely beautiful. Really special.
Where do you reckon you're going, eh? Eh? You're not on my guest list. Nah, I can't see your name down here anywhere. Well, Sunshine, you ain't coming in, and don't bother arguing. I've turned away some seriously big names in my time. For starters, there was... All right. Yeah. Yeah. Right, yeah. Yeah, if you say so. Right, if you insist, yeah. Apparently the promoter says you can come in. Special case. Says he wants to show you what's been going on during the last 10 years. Step this way. Thank you.
Like you lot had a good time in 1998. Come to think of it, you've been having a good time for the last 10 years. I wonder if you'll do the same in 1999. Will Clublife ever be this sweet? Or will it all go a bit, well, Pete Tong? Stay tuned and find out.